So we know from monopoly theory, if these graphs are drawn correctly, and those assumptions are correct, what they're gonna do is restrict output over the entire market.
I did not know what that was.
They're gonna raise the price over the competitor.
Yes.
They're gonna reduce the consumer surplus. This would be in a perfectly competitive pricing environment. This would be all consumer surplus. We're gonna reduce it now to just this thing I'm trying. So consumer surplus is hard, it's reduced. They're gonna earn this monopoly profit rectangle. That's an abnormal profit above a competitive rate. And then you've got the deadweight loss triangle, the inefficiency, the gains from trading that were made, complete inefficiency at that point. You'd expect all of this. And there it is. You see it right there. Then we had another type of monopoly. I think we went on over after the exam was over. This is the perfect price discrimination monopoly. Now, this one has five total assumptions. The three for monopoly, which is what? Look at your notes. Barriers to entry, no substitutes, price maker. They can't sell all they want at the market price without changing the market price. Okay, those are the three monopoly assumptions, but there's two more. They can separate their buyers, so they can charge different prices to different people, and they can prevent resale of the product, arbitrage. So if they know who the buyers are on the demand curve, they can separate. They could charge A, let's say $10 for the first unit. And then to sell an additional unit, they don't lower the price to A. They just lower the price to the next buyer, B. So A pays 10, but B pays 9. If they want to sell another unit, they're only going to lower the price to the next guy, the margin. C is going to pay 8. They're going to track out that demand curve. We got different prices, we got different quantities, and notice we're adding down the price column to get total revenue. And that change in the total revenue is your marginal revenue, and then notice the marginal revenue becomes the price. So notice the marginal revenue curve becomes the demand curve. Pivots right back up, just like in perfect price combination. They don't have to lower price on all the previous stuff to sell additional stuff. They just lower the price on the additional stuff. So they're going to get this revenue rectangle, this revenue, this revenue, this revenue, and in the limit, they're going to track out the demand. So now what they're going to end up doing is producing the perfectly price competitive level of output. That's where they stop production. But they're going to charge a whole slew of monopoly prices, a schedule of monopoly prices. There's not one price. There's a whole bunch of monopoly prices to the different buyers in that area. So this entire area, which should have been maybe consumer surplus in perfect price competition, becomes monopoly transfer. They take all the gains from trade are made, but they're just going to the monopolies, not the consumer. Are you with me so far? So this is a perfectly efficient monopoly. But you need those two extra assumptions. They can separate the buyers from that resale. Now, where is this kind of monopoly more prevalent? Is in services. This is hard to retrade services, whereas in physical goods, you can get arbitrage and re-exchange. So if you can't separate the buyers, you don't know who's willing to pay what, or you can't prevent the low-value buyers from reselling to high-value buyers, and that type of monopoly becomes that type of monopoly. Those two extra assumptions is what's allowing that marginal revenue curve to become the demand curve. Okay. Now we have something else, another form of monopoly called cartels. Now again, here we are with the long run average total cost curve. And we're gonna see about cartels. Cartels are when firms act in collusion. They act in concert with each other. Now let's say we're flip-flop shoemaking companies. We all have flip-flop making companies. And let's say the competitive market price is $5 per unit. The price is marginal revenue. You said marginal revenue equal to marginal cost. And each firm in the cartel wants to produce that much output. Now, think about it. So let's say the competitive price is $5. Every one of us is charging $5 for our flip-flops we're going to sell at the beach in Ocean City. Now, if I try to charge more than five, but none of you do, I lose all my customers. I'm off the demand curve. If you try to charge more than five and I don't, you lose your customers to me. You're off the demand curve. What if all of us try to act in unison? Can we change the price of shoes? Yeah. So let's say we form a cartel and we jack that price up to $8 for a pair of flip-flops. Let's just say. Now that's going to be our revenue on each unit we sell, $8 per unit, right? The rule for profit maximization is marginal revenue equals marginal cost. So this is kind of what's incentivizing every firm in the cartel to want to produce more than enough competition. Perfect price competition, each firm in the cartel wants to produce that much of volume. But at this higher cartel or monopoly price, each firm wants to produce more than they would under competition. That's incentive to cheat. That's monopoly profit dangling in front of each of us to break our agreements. The incentive to cheat is this area right here. So I'm moving up the cost curve a little bit, so that's going to raise our cost per unit. But all of this is monopoly profit. And we're now in a prisoner's dilemma. Remember the prisoner's dilemma? Tested on it, and guess what? You're going to be tested again and again, right? That's when people form groups to advance their own interests. However, wants in the group pursue their own gain at the expense of the group. When everyone in the group behaves this way, the group suffers, and everyone in the group is worse off. So now they're trapped in a prisoner's dilemma, aren't they? It's in our collective interest to restrict output and raise price. But aren't we going to put our own greed ahead of the group's benefit? Yeah, you can guess, what do they want more? Profits more for themselves or for the overall group? Well, more for themselves. And if you can make more profits by cheating on the arrangement, that's what you're going to do because of all that excess return. Now, okay, so this is kind of the diagram of cartels. And again, I'm not going to make you draw this because we're taking blackboard examples. You have to understand the terminology. And there are four reasons, write this down, four reasons cartels will fail on a free market. There are four reasons now that are going to fall out of this. Why cartels will fail on a free market. Number one, you have to overcome the incentive to cheat and the prisoner's dilemma. Don't I have a vested interest in saying, you charge eight, I'll charge eight, you charge eight, we all charge eight, and get a higher monopoly price and get some monopoly profits? While you're all charging eight, guess what I might do? Charge $7.50 and steal all your customers. Right? And if I'm cheating, guess what you're probably doing to me? You're cheating? Yeah, you probably charge $7.25. Yeah. So you gotta overcome individual greed in the group setting. Because the prisoner's dilemma and incentive to cheat. That's number one. Number two, you gotta prevent entry into the industry. See, there is no theory of monopoly without barriers to entry. You have to have a barrier or you cannot have a monopoly. It's not even possible. It's not even imaginable to have monopoly without a barrier. Now why is it? Let's say we jack the price up to $8 for a pair of flip-flops. We're earning, you know, maybe $2 and let's say 90 cents maybe the cost for that. So monopoly profit on each unit we sell, let's just say. Well, we're going to earn an abnormally high rate of return, aren't we? That's monopoly profits. It's more than the competitive rate of return. So people that aren't in our flip-flop making cartel, are they going to want to start making flip-flops? Let's say we're making 20% rate of return and other industries are making 5%. What are they going to try to cut in on? They're going to come in on this action, right? I mean, we can sit there and say, please don't make flip-flops. Please let us make all the money. How well do you think that will work in a world of greedy investors? See, I know you can make a lot more if you come in my business, but don't come into my business. Please let me make it all. That ain't gonna work. That ain't gonna work. You gotta have a barrier to entry. There's DC rule. There's gotta be a barrier between your monopoly returns and other people's greed from coming after that. Other investors are greedy too, not just the cartel members, not just the cops. Everyone's greedy. They're looking for the highest rate of return they can get. Right? So if someone's got a great investment and earning multiples on the competitive rate of return, everybody in his brother's gonna come unless there's some barrier to stop them from coming. Number three, there are monitoring or policing costs. Now, why is that true? Well, because I know you have every incentive to cheat. You know I have every incentive to cheat. Don't we gotta watch each other, don't we? Try to catch the cheater, so to speak. That'll erode some of those monopolistic things. And last, fourth reason, have to stop all methods of non-price competition. So let's say we have a flip-flop shoe cartel. We're all kind of honest Johns with each other on the price. We all post the price in our store windows, $8. And we're watching each other charging $8. Okay, now we're going to make some monopoly product. Well, isn't there other ways than to compete than just on the price? Oh yeah, here's Restici rule of business. There's an infinite number of ways to compete that have nothing to do with the price. Whatever consumer desires, that's a way to compete. So let's say we have the flip-flop price posted. $8 per pair of flip-flops in my store, your store, your store, your store. We think, man, we really got this monopoly price thing. Well, here's what I might do. I'll keep the price at $8. And then when customers come in, I'll say, well, if you buy the flip-flops, I'm going to give you a free bottle of suntan lotion. Throw in other goods. Does that shave the price? Yeah, but the value of the suntan lotion, isn't it? What if I say, well, if the flip-flops break, I give you a full refund. The other guys won't need the refund. Guarantees, warranties, things like that. Isn't that a way to compete? Because consumers might like that. Or I'll repair it for free. How about this? How about convenience? Every one of you all close your shops at 6 o'clock. I'm open until 10 o'clock. People that want flip-flops between 6 and 10. Yeah, that's kind of a way of making it more easier for consumers to get to my stuff, and so forth. So there's quality, there's service, there's all different kinds of variables that matter to a consumer. Price is important, but it's not the only factor that matters. And once you understand that there's just an amazing array of margins on which to compete, the competition ain't going down the price margin, it's going to go down another margin. That's what greed does, is get your customer, make your profit, compete on something else, and that's exactly what will happen. So you have to stop all methods of non-price competition. Now, okay, so it's four reasons cartels fail on a free market. And it was the great Adam Smith that first noted most of this. In the book, The Wealth of Nations, remember our founding father, our science, said, he wrote the book, The Wealth of Nations. And here's what he says about cartels in 1776. Just listen to this and think about that graph. He says, quote, people of the same trade seldom meet together, even for merriment or diversion. But the conversation ends in a conspiracy against the public or some contrivance for its prices. That's the first sentence of the paragraph. He says, every time I see people of the same business, same trade, get together, they're not having merriment and diversion. What does merriment mean in 1776? It means like party. They're not doing this to party. Diversion means, you know, getting away from the stresses of business, relaxation. That's not what they're doing. So every time they get together, the greed's taking over. They're trying to screw the consumer by raising prices. So he's taking a very realistic view of business and collusion. Very honest about this. Now, what a lot of people that look at that say, well, Adam Smith was a pro-competition economist. Yes, he was. In fact, this is why all economists are pro-competition economists today, because of Adam Smith's destruction of monopoly in the Wealth of Nations. And then they will then say, well, then he must favor anti-monopoly laws. That is not correct. Here's the next sentence of the same paragraph. They usually use that quote and put dot, dot, dot. Here's the whole paragraph. Listen to these words. People of the same trade seldom meet together, even for merriment or diversion. But the conversation ends in a conspiracy against the public or some contrivance to raise prices. Next sentence of the same paragraph. It is impossible indeed to prevent such movements by any law which either could be executed or would be consistent with liberty and justice. But though the law cannot hinder people of the same trade from sometimes assembling, it ought to do nothing to facilitate such assemblies, much less render them necessary. That's the full paragraph. So what does he say? He's saying, whenever some businessmen get together, try to screw the consumer. He says, but you can't tell people they cannot communicate with one another. It's a fundamental principle of freedom of association. You get to talk to anybody you want to talk to. Are you with me? It is impossible indeed to prevent such meetings by any law which either could be executed with liberty and justice. Because part of freedom is to be able to talk to whoever the hell you want to in this life. He said they have a right to talk with whoever they want to. Then he goes on, he goes, but though the law cannot hinder people from the same trade from sometimes assembling, you ought to do nothing to encourage or facilitate such assembly. In other words, the government should not be telling business people of the same trade, you need to get together. Because we know what's going to happen when you do that. You're going to try and rig the prices, right? Much less render them necessary. That last clause is legal monopolies, legal cartels. Those were mercantilist cartels. Everything in the wealth of nations is an attack on mercantilism and government-sanctioned monopolies. The whole treatise is just one big demolition of government-sanctioned monopolies. So you never want to have those kind of cartels. Why? Because the government can, by law, render them necessary. Now greed cannot break up those cartels. Government cartels. Government. As Adam Smith would have pointed out, government is always the source of all monopoly in every economy. Always. Let me give you some examples of this. Quote, rendered necessary, so to speak. You can look at this graphic here, and we'll go through this. There's a citrus cartel in America. Citrus cartel, which is oranges, grapefruits, lemons, and limes. And if you ever buy fresh fruit at the grocery store, you see that little stamp that says Sunkissed. Sunkissed, you see they ink it, fruit. That's a cartel. They call it a cooperative, agriculture cooperative, which is created by what's called an agricultural marketing order. It's an order that was established by the U.S. Department of Agriculture at the behest of the citrus growers. Now, when you go into citrus industry, buy an orange grove, lemon grove, grapefruit grove. So you have to join a citrus cartel by law. These are not optional. By law. And they will give you what's called a production quota allocation. They will tell you how much of your crop you can legally sell. So they'll go out and assess the whole crop. Sunkist will go out and assess it, and they'll issue you your allocation. So they may say, well, okay, they know they have to get every firm to produce less to get the price. So what they'll do is they might say, you can only sell 60% of your oranges, maybe 70% of your grapefruits, half of your lemons. That's all you're legally allowed to sell. And you might say, well, wait a minute, I bought this land. Those are my trees. I can sell all I want. No, you can't. You go to jail. You have to get a production allocation quota from a cartel. It's a private cartel that has police power now. If you do not do this, then the Sunkist will call the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Federal marshals will show up at your farm and say, where's your production allocation quota? And if you say, I don't have one, they're going to say you're going to jail. See, jail has a way of enforcing monopoly. Now, you might say, why do they do this? Well, you got to ask the question, who was the lobbyist that wanted agricultural marketing orders? It was the citrus industry. It's the citrus industry. and this allows them to keep the price artificially high. So for oranges,
you're so lucky,
grapefruits, lemons, and limes, you pay about 25 to 30% higher than free market prices.
Yeah.
25 to 30% higher than free market prices. You're not allowed to sell the excess. You can't leave your farm. What ends up happening is each farmer is going to want to grow even more at those artificially high prices.
Damn.
And the only reason that you might do that is you might hope maybe some other part of the state the output is less because of drought, hurricanes, or something else, you'll get some more in the quota. Every firm is going to grow more, but then they got to take even more of it off the market. So every year we take about 200 million pounds of perfectly good oranges and put them in the landfills. They dig trenches, put the oranges in, and cover them up with dirt. 80, 90 million pounds of grapefruit, we just put it right in the ground and cover it up. 40 million pounds of lemons, in the ground, covered up. 20 million pounds of limes. You're not even allowed to legally give it away. If you say, well, there are poor people out there, why don't we give it to soup kitchens and homeless shelters? You cannot do that. That's against the law. It's rendered necessary because the cartel is ordering you to get rid of this stuff. If that stuff reaches the market, what happens to the market price? It's going to fall. It's going to, in fact, fall even below the competitive rate when all of them are overproducing at the same time, right? So we have citrus cartel because they were the lobbyists to get this. Most consumers don't know about this. They just see the nice little labels of sunglasses. They don't realize, okay, monopoly prices for citrus. We overgrow it, and then we trash it and destroy it away. There's a cherry cartel. Same exact thing. Need an agricultural marketing order for that. Nectarine board. There's a nectarine board. Same exact thing. When you buy nectarines at the grocery store, you're paying about 30% above the free market price. And what happens is, since they overgrow the nectarines at that artificially high price, they have to take even more off the market. How the nectarine board does it is they measure the diameter of the nectarine. And if they want to reduce the supply on the market, they make the legal nectarine even bigger. They'll add an extra millimeter or two. So what's a legal nectarine today, next year, is not allowed to be sold on the market. Are you with me? The nectarine growers lobbying for the nectarine. Same story, same exact thing. Lots of monopoly out there. There's a raisin board for sun-dried raisins, which are grapes, which are raisins, and also sun-dried fruits. There's an almond board, there's peanut licensing laws. If you're gonna raise peanuts, you gotta get a license for that. They tell you how many acres of peanuts that you can actually plant. There's a sugar quota program that restricts the importation of sugar in America. Now see, this tells the story very quickly. When you think about sugar in America, it comes from two sources. Sugar beets, which there are 10,000 sugar beet farmers in America, in Louisiana, Florida, some states where they can grow sugar beets. And cane sugar, which comes out of Hawaii, the tropics. Are you with me so far? That is only a fraction of the sugar we consume. The rest has to come from outside the country, from either Brazil, Philippines, Thailand. We have to import this. Well, they heavily restrict that. So we pay three times the world price for sugar, raw sugar on the import. American consumers pay $4.1 billion higher sugar prices every year. $4.1 billion per year. So this might be like $15 a person, maybe $50 for a family of three or four in higher food costs. Are you with me? How many consumers actually know about the sugar quota program? None. How about the sugar growers? They got a lobbying group a block away from Capitol Hill, Sugar Growers Association of America. And you look at it this way, and you say, okay, so there's 10,000 beet sugar farmers. $4.1 billion in higher prices for 10,000 farmers is $410,000 per sugar farmer. Guess why they got a lobbying group and you don't?
You don't even know about it.
They know about it. They're going to make sure that that sugar stays out of the country to keep the price artificially high. In agriculture, virtually everything that has the word cooperative in front of it is a cartel. If it has agriculture marketing order, it's a monopoly. We have milk minimum price thresholds, profit thresholds, that say the price of milk cannot fall below a certain level. They force wants you to raise the price of milk, and so forth. We can look at other types of cartels. How about in Virginia, ABC stores? Okay, who owns all the ABC stores? State of Virginia does. If I go into business and I want to sell Jack Daniels or vodka in my store, what's going to happen? I go to jail. You can sell alcohol if it's in the form of wine and beer. You sell whiskey, you're going to prison. Are you with me? The state of Virginia has the monopoly on this. You have to buy it from one of their ABC stores. Are you with me? Oh, there's monopoly. Tons of monopoly in the market. I went to suits and go, well, we have a free market. I'm like, in what universe do you live? There's monopoly everywhere. All you have to do is just look, you'll see it. Most people don't know about any of this stuff. We have taxi medallion monopolies. What is that? In 1937 in New York City, the limousine and taxi service, they were lobbied the city of New York City to limit the number of taxis on the road. And they limited them to like 11,000. And they issued these blue metal plates that screw on the hoods of the taxis. They're called medallions. Now, since 1937, you have like 80 something years here, they haven't increased the number of medallions, but the population has increased tremendously over that near century. Now, to get a taxi on the streets of New York City, you have to have the blue metal plate screwed on the hood of your car. But the only way to get it, since they created the barrier to entry back in 1937, is you have to buy it from an existing medallion holder. So these become transferable monopoly rights, which then will capitalize the discounted value of the monopoly profit rectangle. So about 8 or 9 years ago, a major study on the market price of taxi medallions in New York City. To get one medallion from an existing holder of a medallion, the cost of that medallion transfer was $1.2 million per medallion per car. So if Rastisi wants to put 10 cars on the street called Rastisi Taxi Company, I've got to buy 10 medallions. I need $12 million just for this damn little metal plate to screw on the hood of the car. Okay, I got to buy the car, I got to pay the insurance, get the license, okay, that's all understandable. Then I got to pay $12 million to buy out other people's monopoly right. Are you with me so far? It was the taxi and limousine companies that lobbied for that restriction, because all the existing taxis and limousines were given the medallion free. But then they put that barrier to entry in 1937, and now you run into a bigger problem called transitional gains tax. So if you look at the taxi market today, New York City, Chicago, and other places that have these medallions, the existing holders of medallions are not the people that originally got those medallions. Over this last 80 years or so, they've been selling the medallions to people trying to enter the market. Now look at where you're at.
I should have used that.
If you have a taxi medallion today, you're going to be charging monopoly prices, but you do not receive monopoly profits because you had to pay $1.2 million per car to enter into that market. So the consumers are screwed into perpetuity. If you deregulate and you say, just let anybody that gets the car licensed and insured, called taxi on the top, go into the market, what happens to the value of those medallions? Goes to zero. There's no monopoly profit with this. And then there's going to be $13 billion of medallion values that are wiped out. And the existing holders who bought those medallions are going to be complaining very quickly. They're going to say, we bought the right to enter, and now you're wiping out that asset completely after we paid $1.2 million per medallion. So notice, if you don't deregulate, you screw the consumers forever. If you do deregulate, you're going to screw the existing holders who actually legally bought the permit to be licensed to be on the streets. So then you only have one or two extra options. Another option that has been often proposed is to have government buy out all the medallions. Well, 1.2 million times 11,000, you're at $13 billion of new taxes that the city would have to do. And as a consumer and taxpayer, you might be wondering, why do I got to pay $13 billion more taxes? Just to have a competitive market again. Because of something that was created 80-something years ago. Yeah, that's the problem you run into. That's exactly the problem. So without a hard, exogenous technological shock, these systems are perpetual loss systems. A monopoly just creates inefficiency and efficiency and efficiency, and there's just not a real way to get out of it. Fortunately, we've had some of a hard exogenous shock. It's called Uber and Lyft, right? Which is a way to circumvent the medallions. And of course, you can guess who wants to outlaw Uber and Lyft and things like that in New York City. Taxi companies. They're like, we had to pay $1.2 million per car just to get on the street. We need monopoly prices just to even break even at this point. And here comes an Uber car that's not considered a taxi. You see the politics, it makes it almost impossible at this point. Well, we can go on. Tariffs are a form of monopoly. All tariffs are a form of monopoly, write that down. If you advocate tariffs, you advocate monopoly, let's be honest. What is a tariff? It's a tax on what? Import competition? You're actually taxing entry into that market. Yeah, we could go on and on and on. There's a slew of monopolies. Public utility regulation, it's all monopoly created by government. Anywhere there's monopoly, there's a government regulation somewhere that's restraining competitive greed from coming in. It has to be something. Because other investors are greedy, they want higher rates of return. And you prohibit them from coming in, then you've created an effective monopoly. Now, a few last points here. I could go on. I teach antitrust law and economics. I go through 200 pages. We don't have time to do it. Now I want to talk about a few more things. Contestability of policies. William Baumol. Now William Baumol was a professor of economics at New York University. I believe tragically died a few years ago. He was nominated for the Nobel Prize in Economics for his essays on contestability in the 1970s. The Gordon Street textbook mentioned Baumol and the contestability hypothesis. Now, here's what the hypothesis states, and then I'll give you many examples. Here we go. Where sunk costs are zero or trivial, where sunk costs, notice this is going to bring sunk costs back. Are zero or trivial, potential bidders are just as good as actual competitors for maintaining competitive markets. That little hypothesis got him nominated for the Nobel Prize, because this will shake the earth on such a massive scale. Now, remember sunk cost? We've already gone over this. What are sunk costs? They're historical costs. They're the part of the decision once you make you can't undo, you can't reverse it. Are you with me? So in economics, we basically said they don't matter. And the only reason they even study sunk costs is to not fall for the mistakes and fallacies. Baumol is going to say that sunk cost is important for other things to deal with monopoly and competition, because it can be a barrier to entry, which can create monopoly. This has ramifications. Okay, so let's look at this. For sunk costs, that's part of a choice that you make, you can't undo. Baumol's going to say it's very important for contestability. And contestability redefines monopoly and competition. Now we know what monopolies have to do. We know what they have to do. They've got to restrict the output to jack that price up, earn the monopoly profit, and yet no one enters this market because of barriers to entry. So we can now see this. Monopoly is now defined by its behavior. That the monopolist can restrict output and or raise price. They're earning abnormally high rates of return. No one else's greed is coming to get that on entry. This is maybe a barrier right there. He's going to argue sunk cost can't be that kind of a barrier. Now, before William Baumol, the way economists and other researchers looked at monopoly and competition is they would count the actual number of sellers and then try to make an inference about competition or monopoly. And Baumol is going to prove, scientifically, that the number of sellers in a market has nothing to do with monopoly or competition. The number of actual suppliers in the market tells you nothing about monopoly or competition. Nothing. Contestability will tell you pretty much everything. Now, why is that? Let's give you an example. Let's say, for the sake of argument, we have this. Let's say we have one firm in an industry, call it X. Maybe X makes pens. There's only one seller in the whole market, and he's got 100% of the sales of pens. So this circle is the whole market for pens, all the pens sold in the country. But maybe he's a single seller, not because of some legal protection, grant of monopoly, or tariff, or anything like that. He's the only seller. Let's go with it. Now, let's say over here we have the shoe industry, and these Z's are shoe companies. And let's say five of the shoe companies make up 100% of the total sales of shoes in America. Are you with me? Now, before William Baumol's essays in the early 70s, the way competition monopoly was done is they count the number of sellers. And they'd say, well, we only see one company here, so that has to be a monopoly. And here we have five competitors, so this must be more competition, more competitive than this. Baumol proves this is scientifically invalid. You cannot make any inference, write this down, you can make no inferences about monopoly or competition from the actual number of suppliers. It all depends on contestability. You can make no inferences about monopoly or competition from the actual number of suppliers. It all depends on contestability. Now, let me prove this to you, and we're going to tie this all back together again. Let's say this firm looks around and says, I'm the only one selling pens. I'm the only one there. Maybe these Y's are pencil companies. They're not actually in the pen market. And let's say this company decides to behave this way. He's going to try and restrict output, jack price, and earn monopoly profits. Now X is going to be earning this abnormally high rate of return, dollar for dollar. Okay. These are pencil companies. What are they going to want to become? Become pen companies. Maybe they earn 5 cents on every dollar invested. And maybe to enter into this market, they can earn 20% rate. Because that monopoly profit. Are you with me? Greed's going to come to this market, isn't it? So Y's are going to turn into X's. Potential competition now becomes actual competition. So this is potential competition. We don't call peripheral competition. It's kind of waiting in the wings, as you would say. So when this guy restricts output and raises price, it behaves like a monopoly. That's what we define monopoly, it's behavior. Then the actual competitors now start flooding in. Potential competitors become the actual competitors. And here comes the tsunami. Pen companies, okay. Are Are you with me? Now, let's say for the sake of argument, X looks around and says, uh-oh, there's a whole bunch of pencil companies starting to make pens. And I don't have any legal monopoly that can prevent them. So maybe I'll expand output, lower price, maybe push them back out of the marketplace. Okay. If there's low sub cost, zero or trivial, what can these pencil companies that are started making their pen companies do? Can't they reverse back? If there's no sunk cost, they get all their investment back out, don't they? There's nothing that they'll lose. Question, do they ever have to enter to exert discipline on the single seller? They never have to enter. They just have to potentially enter. Are you with me? So, if you're counting the actual number of suppliers, and this person is not behaving this way, they're behaving like a perfect price competitor, would Y's have any incentive to want to become X's? No. You would count one supplier, as Bommel would point out, that is behaving as a perfect price competitor, and then try to infer monopoly from that, which is completely insane. There's no monopoly there. On the other hand, if you go over here and you say, well, I see five competitors, there must be some competition here. Bommel says you can't infer that. Because now you could have a cartel, and let's say it's an effective cartel, and notice there's no peripheral or potential competitors waiting to enter that industry. Now, why might they be not there? Because maybe there's high sunk cost. So if you have high sunk cost and you enter the shoemaking industry, and then you reverse and come out, you may not be able to get your money out, which then means you may not come in when there's a monopoly profit opportunity. Therefore, this could be a very tight monopoly, but you're calling it competitive. This, you can have one seller have 100% of the total sales, and it's acting as a perfect price competitor. You can't count the number of suppliers and make any inference about monopoly or competition. It all depends on potential competition, potential entry, and that is really going to be defined by sunk cost. So if they enter, because he restricts output, raises price, then the potential competition becomes the actual suppliers, which are counting. If he never restricts output, never raises price, never behaves this way, they have no incentive to come in. You're counting one, and you're falsely inferring that it's monopoly, and it's actually behaving like the price competition. Size does not make a firm monopoly. It's a common mistake people do. They'll think big means monopoly. It doesn't mean monopoly at all. It tells you nothing about monopoly. Right? So, you know, think about this. The sugar quota program has 10,000 beet sugar farmers. You normally think that's competition. They've got monopoly quotas on import restrictions. They're barriers. Barriers. And sunk cost can be a potential barrier. If sunk cost isn't there, or it's very low or trivial, and there are no other legal barriers, then you don't have to enter the industry to force the single seller to behave like a perfect price competitor. You're waiting in the wings, and that's enough. That's all it takes. And this guy to realize, I can't behave this way. And the potential competitor to become an actual competitor. This guy got nominated for the Nobel Prize. Just earth-shattering. So if someone says, well, that's a big company, it must be a monopoly, they don't know what they're talking about. They don't know their head from holding ground at this point. If they say, well, this industry has five firms and this one has two firms, and the one with two firms is less competitive, they don't know their head from holding ground. You cannot count the number of suppliers for anything about monopoly or competition. It's all about barriers to entry. No barriers, no monopoly. Sunk costs, as he points out, can be a barrier of potential competition. Changed the whole world. I want to talk about one last thing before we get to an actual Supreme Court case dealing with monopoly and competition. Now, in America, we got federal antitrust statutes. And we don't have just one antitrust law, five or six of them. And different laws make different things illegal, behaviorally. Under various antitrust statutes at the federal level, if you raise your price, you can be prosecuted. Because raising your price above your competition can be deemed monopolistic pricing. So they go to the assumptions of the perfect price competition model. In that model, can any wheat farmer raise the price of wheat? No. So they say, if you can raise the price and not lose all of your sales, you've now proven your monopoly. So they go to the assumptions of the perfect price competition model to criminalize raising your price above your competition. Why did we have those six assumptions of the perfect price competition model? There's only one reason we made that assumption. To draw graphs. To draw graphs, draw pictures. So these are people, again, who don't know their head from pulling the ground. But yet, you can be prosecuted. If you lower your price below your competition, you can be prosecuted for being a monopoly. You say, wait, a monopoly is supposed to raise price. Yeah, I know. And if you lower price, they'll get you prosecuted for being a monopoly. And they'll call this predatory tactics. And under the Robinson-Patman Act of 1936, you can be prosecuted for lowering your price below your competition's cost. Maybe that's just competition. So they'll say if you're lowering your price, you're trying to drive out the competitors. Then when you're the only seller left, then the argument goes, then you're gonna raise the price and be a monopoly. Are you with me? Of course, this is delusional because you're taking losses up front and can't recover the monopoly prices. But there are some statutes that make it illegal to lower your price. Because lowering your price now is considered monopoly. So raising price is considered monopoly. Lowering price below your competition is considered monopoly. Under different statutes. And under other statutes, charging the same price is illegal. They call this tacit collusion. Price fixing. Now they're going to invoke signaling theory, and they'll look for synchronized price movements. And say, in an industry, if prices are moving in synchronization, there must be some collusion going on, signaling each other. You raise price, I'll raise the price. You raise this. Every pricing decision is already illegal in the United States. Everything. Raise your price, lower your price, charge the same price. You can be prosecuted. There's no price step, no legal price in America.
I think it changed.
Every price is already illegal. Now, since the federal government and the Federal Trade Commission and Justice Department cannot prosecute every decision, then the question is, how do they determine what they are going to prosecute on? Well, that's a political decision. That's a political decision, which means this is purely arbitrary. Purely arbitrary, that's why I don't like to call antitrust laws law, because law cannot be arbitrary and be able to be law. Okay? Let me give you an example of this last one, synchronized price movements. Okay, so let's say OPEC restricts the supply of oil. It's an international cartel. These are all governments, right? Now, if the price of a barrel of oil goes up $10 a barrel tomorrow, what's going to happen to the gas price at every gas station? Millions of gas stations are going to start raising the price of gas. Are you with me? Does that mean millions of gas stations are synchronizing a big cartel? No, they're all using a homogeneous input into what? Gasoline, right? It's all homogeneous input. So the cost curves on every single one has shifted upwards of the price of the barrel of crude. They're calling that monopoly when that's just perfect price competition. Monopolies on the input side. Not the sales of the consumers. Are you with me? Yeah, this is where people have enough understanding of economics to be dangerous and don't realize how dangerous their thinking is. Yeah. I didn't realize this so much until I had to teach antitrust law and economics. That everything is illegal from the start, and then they're just gonna pick whatever they want to prosecute you. That is not an economics decision. That's purely 100% a political decision on who to go after. There's not one law that says all three things are illegal. There's overlapping statutes that criminalize this, criminalize that, criminalize this, this, and this, and under that totality, everything now to be defined is breaking the code. Okay, now I want to talk about an actual empirical case. We're going to put all of our tools together. We'll start into this, spend 20, 25 minutes on this, and then we're going to, on Wednesday, finish this up. We don't have time to go through it all. I'll leave this up where I take pictures of this. All right, this comes down. The biggest case in American history on antitrust was the 1911 Standard Oil New Jersey case. And this was the case against John D. Rockefeller. Now, when you teach a course in antitrust law and economics, you have to read the cases. And these cases go thousands of pages, so you've got to sift through enormous volumes of detail. And most people think they know what happened, or at least have been told what happened, but yet we're never given any serious data. This is the data from the Supreme Court case against Rockefeller. Now, I always ask students, I say, how many of your teachers in high school, college have said something about Rockefeller was a monopoly at Standard Oil and they had to break him up for harming the consumers and other people? How many have heard something like that? How many of those teachers ever gave you any data from the case? I've asked this question to 50,000 students and I've had probably 45,000 hands raised on the first question and really nobody on the second. Lawyers. If you talk about the biggest case in American history, you have a duty to at least know what the hell you're talking about. Not flippantly just repeat nonsense. I'm keeping this up for the rest of today's lecture because I want you to get this data. When the other teachers ask you this about Rockefeller, they say, oh, he was a monopoly. You got the data. I'm giving it to you. Now, Rockefeller was the greatest business person ever to walk the face of this earth. He was my hero. There was no person more efficient than John D. Rockefeller. Now, we can see this in this data. Now, this first column is the year 1870. This was in the Supreme Court case. The next column is 1890. That's when the Sherman Act came in, our first antitrust law. And then 1911 is the year they broke them up after they had the case. The metrics that the Supreme Court brought in as data were this, horizontal rows. Market price of refined oil, this is in cents per gallon. Standard Oil's output in millions of barrels. They counted the number of competitors. They actually used to do that back in 1911. Here's how many other oil refineries there. Counted that. And Standard Oil's market share, percentage of his part of the industry sales. Are you with me so far? This is the data from the case. This is the facts from the case. Whenever you study a case in law, facts of the case are rules of law, nothing else matters. So now let's look. We know what monopolies have to do. They have to follow this kind of behavior, restrict output, raise price, earn monopoly profits, and no new entry. And we've got a clear visual of this right there with our monopoly model. So now let's look at Rockefeller. Now, there was data in the case from the 1860s, 1880s, and so forth, but they didn't have all four criteria for each of those years. These were the years they had all four criteria reported in the Supreme Court case. So that's why we have just that. Some of them have price data but not output data and so forth. So let's just get the data that's consistent across the board. Rockefeller within a few years is in the oil industry. When he first started, it was 53 cents a gallon. for refined oil. By 1870, it's 26.4 cents. It's like half what it was 10 years earlier. By 1890, he got the price of refined oil down to 7.5 cents a gallon. And when they broke him up in the Supreme Court, he was charging 4.7 cents a gallon. Which way did the price go? Up or down? It went down. This is an 85% drop in the relative price of refined oil. Over a period of 41 years. We have no theory of monopoly that its price is falling for 41 years, because this was consistently down. No theory of monopoly where the price goes down year after year after year after year for 41 years. Something ain't right here. Then you look at, and I'm going to show you how he was able to do this, Standard Oil's output, now it's in millions of barrels. I'm not talking about gallons, I'm talking about millions of barrels. In 1870, 3.9 million barrels a year. 1890, 28.2 million barrels. When they broke them up, he was producing 121 million barrels a year. Did the output go down or up? Up. It went up by a factor of 30 to 1. 30 to 1. He didn't restrict output. He massively is exploding output and massively reducing the price. Are you with me? It is impossible on these first two margins to ever infer anything monopoly here. You have to be using a definition of monopoly that no economist on the planet uses. Number of competitors. In the case they noted in 1870, he had 200 refineries he was in competition with. Rockefeller Standard Oil was a refining company. He wasn't drilling for oil. He took the oil and refined it into refined product. Okay, so in 1870, there were 200 other oil refineries in America. 1890, about half of them disappeared. He crushed them, put them out of business. And then notice what happened between 1890 and 1911 when they broke them up. What happened there? Here comes entry. And how much? He had 43 more competitors here than he had here. Wait a minute, under monopoly, there can't be entry. Are you with me? It's got 147 competitors directly facing it. I don't care what theory of monopoly you've got. If you've got entry coming in, and you've got more entry coming in, you cannot infer monopoly. This is an openly, hotly competitive market. By their own measurements, Standard Oil's market share. In 1870, it was a small company, 4% of total sales. 1890, he's the big player. He's got 88% of the industry sales. He's the big dominant player. That doesn't mean monopoly. Why? Because here comes new competitors, and guess what happens? He loses 24% of the industry sales to all those new competitors. Are you with me? I damn well guarantee you, with perfect certainty, when you heard someone go, "Oh, Rockefeller was a monopoly," they didn't tell you price went down 85%. They didn't tell you output went up by a factor of 30 to 1. They didn't tell you he had 147 direct competitors and 43 more than 21 years earlier. And they didn't tell you he lost a quarter of the entire market share during that time. No, they don't tell you, they don't give you data. They just repeat stuff. Are you with me? I got no patience for this kind of garbage. This is the data from the case. Next time anybody tells you Rockefeller's a monopoly, they don't know what the hell they're talking about. He was a very aggressive competitor. But let me explain to you how he did this, how he pulled this off. One of the things Rockefeller did, he was enormously efficient. And one of the big costs of refining and distributing refined oil was in the containers. And they used to have these guys called coopers. What a cooper would do is make a custom-made barrel. They used to refine oil and put it in wooden barrels. Are you with me? Transport the wooden barrels to the city where the distribution centers. The price of a wooden barrel when Rockefeller entered the oil industry was $2.50 a barrel. Now, this was huge because this was equivalent to 3 days' wages for a median income worker. to have a custom-made barrel. In our dollars today, median income, $55,000 a year, roughly $1,000 a week, what's 3 days' wages? $600 per wooden barrel. Pretty expensive, would you say? Now, they would use these wooden barrels, and after they used them 3 or 4 times, they start leaking because the refined oil breaks down the fibers of the wood in the slats. So they would have to patch them, tar them, try to get them salvageable. And after a few more uses, then they had to throw them away and buy new barrels. So Rockefeller said, is there a cheaper way to get barrels? Instead of having these guys make them piece by piece, and his engineers used the assembly line technology to make barrels. So they would have the lumber yards make pre-cut slats that are interchangeable, take them on a conveyor, one guy would put the slats together, another one put the hoop around it, another one put the rim on it. Are you with me? The first business to use the assembly line technology was Rockefeller. It was not Henry Ford. Henry Ford was the first to use it in cars. Rockefeller beat Henry Ford to this in 30, 40 years. He got the cost of making a wooden barrel from $2.50 down to 96 cents. Massive reduction in the cost of making the barrels. So while his competitors are buying custom-made barrels, he's mass-producing barrels to get that cost down, and he can lower his price a few pennies and still be competitive. Then he went to his engineers and said, look, is there any way we can ship oil without going to making barrels? We know we're going to use them 3 or 4 times to throw the barrels away. Is there another way to do it? And the engineers at Standard Oil invented oil tanker cars that go on railroad tracks. Are you with me? Those steel cylinders, they put thousands of barrels in and reuse it forever. His competitors tried to start making wooden barrels. He's making oil tanker cars. He's ahead of the technology curve. Then he went to the railroads, because he didn't know the railroads. The railroad companies under that. And said, I can give you 60 carloads of refined oil on every shipment. But they have to go over your tracks and use your locomotive to pull it. 60 was the magic number for efficiency for a locomotive at that time. And the way they would do this in the railroad industry is they would jerry-rig things together. They'd have 10 of coal, 5 of wheat, 3 of animals, maybe some of straw, some of people will have some passengers in there. They'll just jerry-rig cars trying to get 60. So he said to the railroad companies, he said, if I give you 60 carloads of oil already pre-done, connected up, these tanker cars, how much are you going to charge me to have your locomotive pull it to the city or your tracks? They gave him massive, massive rebates and discounts, which allowed him to do what? Lower the price of gas? His competitors were trying to make wooden barrels, and he's now shipping these things with oil cylinder cars. So then his competitors start making oil cylinder cars. Rockefeller then said, is there a cheaper way to get oil from our refinery to the city where we're distributing it? Instead of having to pay railroads and build oil tanker cars. And they said, yes, we're going to put pipelines in there. The first petroleum pipelines were Standard Oil. And Rockefeller bought rights of way. He didn't use eminent domain to steal people's land. He bought rights of way, and he would put the pipe in the ground and pump the oil through all the way from the refinery to the city. And once they put that pipe in the ground, the marginal cost of pumping a barrel through that system was zero. He took all of his transportation distribution costs and just smashed it to zero. That allowed him to keep lowering his price. And he was always ahead of the technology curve, always. He's getting those cost curves down, getting those prices down. And in the process, he's taking out these inefficient competitors on a big scale. Now, last few points on this. When you look at the internals of this data, I found this data in the case. Here, Rockefeller was making 4 cents a gallon in profit. Here, he was making 0.25 cents a gallon in profit, 0.25 cents, which means he was making about 10 cents a barrel on refined oil. Now, we don't have profit margins falling, for monopoly, we have them rising, don't we? These are falling. And yet, he became the richest man in the world. He was the world's first billionaire. First billionaire in world history. By lowering the price of refined oil. Are you with me so far? But what puzzled me was, at this point, even with this amount of volume, making 10 cents a barrel, he's making $12 million a year. That's still nothing compared to what he was actually making. So the question is, where was he making most of his money at the end? When you refine oil, and the early years, this is mainly kerosene. Remember, kerosene became a substitute for whale oil. And you get byproduct. One of the byproducts was gasoline. Remember, we talked about this when we went to Mega Chapter 2. And nobody knew what to do with gasoline. All his competitors were dumping gasoline into the rivers and paying people to take gasoline away. Rockefeller had a philosophy. There's gold in the garbage. Don't throw anything away. Find value. Use your brains. Use your imagination. There's got to be a need we can serve with this stuff. So throwing it away, let's get some value out of this stuff. And Rockefeller then developed the entire market for gasoline before the combustion engine comes online. He also took the waste products of refined oil, once he would refine the kerosene, and he made 300 sellable products, consumer and industrial products, out of the garbage. Let me give you just some of these. Gasoline was later the big, big, huge one. But he made paint. Petroleum-based paint came out of Rockefeller. Not DuPont, came out of Rockefeller. He invented the whole paint industry in America on a mass scale. Varnish, lubricants, asphalt, tar, naphtha, just a whole range of things, including Vaseline. How many have heard of Vaseline petroleum jelly? Rockefeller's engineer said, what is this stuff? Some kind of jelly we can use for some things. That became a consumer good. People buy Vaseline for it, right? He came up with 300 sellable products out of the garbage of refined oil. I made this point in one of his friends. At this point, his real money is not on kerosene. This is no profit margin. He's going into the garbage. And he's now, his engineers are creating new technology for new consumer uses on a mass scale, marketing all different kinds of things. Virtually everything you touch has something to do with Rockefeller's great engineers. We're going to go into more Rockefeller in the next slide. Then we're going to make sure the information is brand new. Wednesday, 6:20.